What is a Leon Lifer?
You know, that's a good question. I don't know if I could really adequately explain that.
What is a lifer?
Ooh, that's a hard one.
A Leon Lifer.
I don't know that I would ever be able to explain to you what that's all about.
It's really hard to explain.
I don't know if I can explain. It's kind of like Justice Stewart when he talked about pornography. He said he couldn't explain it, but he knew it when he saw it.
You know, I have tried to explain this to other people about the Leon Lifers, and I got to tell you, 9 times out of 10, they just think I'm ready for the bin.
Well, I didn't know what to think when I first heard about you guys, and we'd even laughed. Are they going to show up in Leon hats with Leon wigs? I mean, were they going to be like Star Trekkies or deadheads?
They're not deadheads, okay? They're not just chasing or hanging on to the coattails. They're keeping up.
And you don't want to recreate at all anything. You just want to bring to fruition what's really happening right now with Leon and in Leon. I mean,
we're not similar at all in a lot of our where we live and what we like to eat or what other things we do in our life.
I live in Nashville. I'm a respiratory therapist / garden columnist / musician.
The people I'd met so far were completely different than I'd expected. Accomplished, grown up, focused.
I work as a research scientist. I'm a molecular biologist, and I've mostly worked in medical research.
Professionally, I am a lawyer who lost his way, if lawyers ever have their way. I practiced law for a number of years and became a client. And now I run a for-profit education company, a public company, listed in the American Stock Exchange. And otherwise, married, father, two kids.
I'm from Central New York. I grew up in the Finger Lakes region. I'm a nurse practitioner in pain management and hematology oncology. I work currently at a VA hospital. I'm master's prepared. I'm married. I don't have any children.
We're all diversified. I mean, earlier we said we've got attorneys and nurses, brewery workers, ministers, people who work in assembly. I mean, we come from so diverse fields, from so diverse backgrounds, different states, different countries.
I'm Sue Carlson, and I'm from San Diego.
I'm Mark Atterbury from Houston, Texas.
Well, I work at a place called Fort James Paper Company in Muskogee.
I do PR for Showtime Boxing.
I work for a company that unloads barges and loads barges with sand and gravel and coal, unloads railroad cars.
I was a bartender for 12 years. I've heard every insult that you can sling at somebody. And almost immediately after that, I pastored for 8 years. So I got 20 years of counseling experience, and you really can't insult me.
I don't see color, I don't see economic status or anything that has to do with it. If you like good music, you like it.
A Leon Lifer is somebody, you know, I feel that Leon hit them musically somewhere in their life. And when you first hear Leon's music, you realize it's something you've almost been looking for musically all the time. You know, some people may be lucky and catch it early, some get it later.
Most of us, except some of the youngsters.
Oh, come on now.
have been following Leon and his music for 30 years.
I have. I'm only 35, but I've been listening to him for
30
years.
Yeah.
First of all, it's probably someone who really enjoys rock music.
Of course, we're an older group. We're not like Christina Aguilera's, you know, fan club or anything.
A Leon Lifer is, I guess, someone who has been fortunate enough, lucky enough, to have been exposed to Leon. I guess it doesn't have to be from the 60s or 70s, but in some ways I think that helps.
They're like the era of the 70s, before it kind of went disco and things like that. So they like that kind of music.
When I was about 19, I had moved away from home, was living in San Diego. My roommate and I both had hair probably down to our waist. doing the blue jeans and army jacket, headband, you know, the hippie thing. And we connected with this guy who kind of looked like us.
We're a bunch of older hippies having our last heyday, that's for sure.
We're kind of a generation sandwich between, you know, our parents who said, turn down your music, and our kids who say, turn down your music, you know, so we're sort of stuck in the middle there. Everybody's telling us to turn it down, and, you know, we're cranking it up a couple of notches.
It's really a phenomenon. I mean, it's a phenomenon because everybody has favorite groups. And what we have and what our generation has staying with these artists that have been around for 30 years, I sincerely doubt that it'll happen with today's groups and today's fans 30 years from now. I mean, there was something about our time that made for this kind of loyalty or just adulation or whatever you want to call it. And none of it was preconceived, none of it was it just happened.
But I think it might be a couple of things. One of the things is the songs that Leon writes. I think if they strike a chord in you, then that means that you're a particular kind of person.
I think there's just a special personal connection that the lifers feel to Leon personally through his music and through his music to other people.
Well, there seems to be one common thing about it. Everybody that I've met, I don't know if it's that we've listened to Leon for so long and the message in his music has come through, but there's a neat bond there. I mean, they're just neat people.
Basically, though, I think if you want to say it in one word, what it is, it's love.
It seems so far what I've met of the lifers, they're all like really earthy, loving, caring people. I made the joke about them being old hippies, but you know, for people today, you know, the hippies were this group back in the day that preached love and loving your fellow man and everything. And I think that's the essence.
One of the first things I ever remember Leon saying on stage was, I want you to remember the power of love and the power of music. And I think that really comes from him, you know, in whatever he does. And we've all been affected by that and taken that on.
I mean, this group is the most humble, modest, giving, kind, willing to help someone else to go that extra mile. And they may do it for other people too, which is great. But that the core, we're all the same. We're all the same. It's really great. And there's no way anybody can predict that. And if you have to, you know, if somebody's got to get responsibility for that, it's Leon and Leon's music.
Unless somebody already knows who Leon is and is already familiar with his music and likes his music, it's very hard to get the point across. And the wheel goes free.
This guy, Leon Russell.
Hello, everybody. I'm Leon Russell.
Are we absolutely 100% certain that's Leon Russell?
Well, no more than I had a broken child, a silly gumbo. Well, honey, tonight I'm gonna see my Geraldine. Biscuit, my, and a few dollars gonna be gay, yo.
sweetest one, be your mind. Son of a gun, we'll have a little fun all the time.
Sweet baby, I'm only round the shack till the bell train come back. And I'm gonna roll in my sweet baby, roll in my sweet baby, roll in my sweet baby now. Mercy! Flashed in my eyes, and there she was standing leaning up against the lamppost.
Well, tell it.
I saw her standing on the corner in yellow ribbon in her hair. All at once my heart just stuttered. Look at there. Yeah.
Look at there.
I'm sorry.
Somewhere on a rainbow, up in the sky, birds fly. Wild in a while, can I
stand up.
Well, looking back at it now, I think unconsciously I was probably involved with Leon's music from about the age of 13 because I was a huge fan of Shindig, but you know, I was too unaware at that age to really be paying attention to anyone unless they were already pretty well known.
Well, it's community sing time on Shindig with Leon Russell stepping down for the bandstand to join Jackie and Gail, Glenn Campbell and Gail Garnett in a round of their favorite songs. Leon, how about a little jambalaya to get things started? Here we go.
Well, goodbye, Joe. We gotta go. Me, oh, my, oh. We gotta go.
Actually, the first time I heard Leon would have been as a young child and my mother playing music. And I kept hearing this piano in the background that had so much more life than any other piano I'd ever heard in my life. And then as I got older, I found Leon himself and did not know that that's who I'd been listening to as I was growing up. And then went back and found that all the things my mother had been listening to, he had been playing on all along, like Herb Alpert and stuff like that.
First time I heard him, I knew that's what I liked. That was my kind of music.
First time I heard his music, I liked it. I didn't know who he was, but I liked that music. When I first heard his voice, it sounded like my relatives. He's from Oklahoma and I'm from the hills, but we don't sound exactly alike, but I recognized that. It wasn't the usual kind of folks that you hear on the radio.
I was about 16 years old and I was in London then and heavily into music, but you know, all sorts of music. And I had a friend called Madeleine and she'd bought this album and we used to exchange albums and listen to music. And I went around there just one Saturday and she was playing this music and I'd never heard anything like it. And I wanted to know more about it. And it was Asylum Choir 2, which was Leon and Mark Benno. And from the minute I heard that, I had to have it.
After school one day, I went over to a friend's house, and she had an older brother. And we walked in the house, and I heard this music, and I was going, wow, who is that? What is that? And went on in his room, and he was playing it on a stereo. And and I was hooked. That very day, I took my allowance money and went and bought the album, Solemn Quartet. Even wrote a review for it for our school newspaper back in the early 70s, you know, when all this happened.
When I heard him the first time, I was riding around at the church one Sunday night, and there was a black local radio broadcast there in Muskogee. And a lot of times after church, I'd ride around and tune that in because I liked the music. Well, I tuned it around there, and I thought I got it on that station, but it was Leon playing with Joe Cocker. I believe it was Give Peace a Chance. And I heard that piano player. And then after that song was over, then I realized, well, it wasn't the station I was looking for. But I mean, that hooked me, and that was actually September 20th, 1970. I know it right down to the day.
First time I heard Leon, I was 13 years old, and I was babysitting for a friend. And they put on side B of the Will of the Wisp album, which is still my all-time favorite. And when I heard the opening bars to Back to the Island, I was just transported. And I've been a fan ever since.
Now the sea is gone.
I remember when I was just a little kid, my dad listened to him. And that's how I started listening to him. Swiping my dad's records, man. I saw that Leon Live album and I said, man, I gotta hear this.
In kind of doing a little more research as time went on, I realized that really I had loved Leon's music for a long time because at a younger age I loved the song Delta Lady, the Joe Cocker cover of that, and you know, again, too young to really be paying attention to who's doing the real work here, and just didn't realize who wrote the song. Never looked at the 45, I guess, to see that. And in the fullness of time, when I realized, wow, that song that I used to play over and over again in my girlfriend's bedroom when I was 16 or 17 years old, it was a Leon song. No wonder I like that song so much.
Well, unfortunately, my memory isn't quite as crystal clear as some of these people. In fact, it's probably worse than everyone's. I just know that I remember the first time I saw him, it was probably 1970 or 71. He was on tour supporting the Leon Russell album, the one with Song for You and Delta Lady. He was the second billed act at an outdoor concert at what was then known as Anaheim Stadium. The Who headlined, then John Sebastian, Leon, and Blues Image. And I remember going into that concert, and we're all only, you know, 19, 20, 21 at that time, that all anybody that I had known or knew about Leon was that he was like Joe Cocker's best friend. That was the... But something happened that day, and ever since that day, I've been a Leon Russell fan.
My mom, she also introduced me to David Bowie as well. She's a really cool little lady. She had bought me Mad Dogs and Englishmen for Christmas. And I was playing it, and you know, like the hippie thing was so cool and everything. And then I heard Girl from the North Country. And I'm like, God, who is that? And then, of course, reading the liner notes and stuff, I saw it was Leon Russell. And then I looked at his picture, I'm like, God, he's so cute. He's, you know, a real hippie dude. And I found out that he was an artist on his own, because before that, I had never heard of him at all. And then I started, you know, once I had heard him on Mad Dogs and Englishmen, it's like, okay, let's investigate this a little more.
I was visiting in Boston, Massachusetts with my boyfriend visiting his sister, and we went to see the movie Mad Dogs and Englishmen. And I was kind of a Joe Cocker fan. And I think, like many other people, I went in to see that film thinking, oh boy, goody Joe, yeah. And walked out of the theater like, Joe who? Who was that guy with that long hair? And I mean, he was just so overwhelming to me. His whole persona and his musicianship. So from that point on, I was completely over the edge about Leon.
I didn't really realize how good that Mad Dog show was until a couple of years ago. Somebody sent me the tape. I was just slapped watching that. I had no idea. I mean, I'd forgotten that you're there every night and you're close to it. The music on that, it's good. I mean, it's good. It's awesomely good.
It really started sort of with the concert of Bangladesh. My sister, at that point in time, she was, I was living in New York and she was visiting me. And she wanted to get down to the concert of Bangladesh to see this Leon Russell, who I didn't know who it was, but I did know the Beatles, you know? So we went down, but of course we didn't have tickets, so we didn't get in.
I'd like to introduce you to a few people up here. Everybody here came at very short notice, and some people even cancelled a few gigs to try and make it, and nobody was getting paid for anything. We got on drums, Ringo Starr. The old friend of mine, Mr. Eric Clapton. Somebody I'm sure you all know by now, on piano, Leon. Stand up, Leon.
That's pretty much the first time I heard his name. But the first time I actually heard him was I had moved to San Francisco, and I walked into a friend of mine's house, and she was playing this album, and all I heard was the piano and the voice. And it just went through me like a bolt of lightning. And I immediately said, "Who's that?" And she said, "Leon Russell." And it's been that way ever since.
But what captured me was the first Leon show that I saw was in probably 1972 in Dania, Florida. He was doing the whole LeonLifer thing. And there was absolutely a power to the music that was evident. And
went to see him, blew me away. Best concert I had ever seen in my life, bar none. I guess I've been to, you know, 20, 30 different concerts by that point in my life. I started going, when I was 15, 16 years old, I started going to concerts. Leon was, he's just absolutely the best.
Blessed with the opportunity of seeing him perform on an acoustic piano and going through his heavily flavored gospel tunes. And I mean, that is just incredibly thrilling music.
Now, I'm not trying to sell anybody on religion tonight. Let me say that again. I'm not trying to sell anybody on religion tonight. But what I'm talking about is the power of music, and I'm talking about the power of love, and I'm talking about the power that will make you get up and shake and dance and sing your love to the world. And I know that I know what I'm talking about. Do you know what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
alone. And I know I'm gonna take you there if you'll help me. I know I'm gonna take you there if you'll help me. I'm gonna take you there before you can count to 1, 2, 3, 4.
It was actually seemed like you'd left a good church service once you had a religious experience when you got to go see Leon.
Got a little thing I want to say to you right now, because I heard on KMET today. I heard on KMET today that last night at the forum we have a pseudo-religious experience. As soon as I got through asking somebody what that meant, I feel like I have to say, if you leave this place tonight and you don't feel like you had a religious experience, why don't you just get your money back? Because I don't need it. You hear me? 1, 2, 3, 4.
Here on the radio station, they had a contest. People called in and said, what was the greatest rock and roll concert ever, you know? And without a doubt, Leon Live, to me, was the greatest rock and roll concert. Not just because I'm a Leon fan, but there were no special effects. There were no, they weren't flying through the air. They weren't, that was pure energy. And it was in a huge, gigantic place, and every single person there was feeling that Leon energy. And he still puts that out today, maybe in a little smaller surrounding, but that was an incredible concert, and I truly believe that was the best rock and roll concert ever.
He was one of the first ones that really brought the piano in rock music, out in the front. It wasn't just, something in the back you could hear every once in a while. But he made that, that's my favorite instrument, and he's the best on it.
Let me hear it again, come on.
Should be teaching science at MIT. I mean, he's a mathematician, basically. That due to an odd course, he got piano lessons at a young age, and then when it came time to go to college, he took a left turn and went out the door with a rock and roll band.
Back in about 1959, when I was getting out of high school, I had a chance to go to Tulsa University, and also along in that same time frame, I had a chance to go on the road with Jerry Lee Lewis. So, of course, I made the obvious choice.
You shake my nerves and you rattle my brain. Too much love drive a man insane. You broke my will, but why don't you? Goodness gracious, great balls of fire.
He's always left me begging for more at the end. You could know how long it could be an hour and 15 minutes, it could be 2 hours and 45 minutes. Musically speaking, he's never let me down live or, on record, CD, 8-track, cassette, whatever.
Many times people, and this is always mind-boggling to me, people aren't necessarily aware of who Leon Russell is. And for example, I was coming here this weekend, who are you going to see? Leon Russell. Well, who? And sometimes it's a function of the person is simply too young. I mean, they're, you know, they weren't even thought of when Shindig was on the air and when Gary Lewis and the Playboys were around, and sometimes not even when at the time of LeonLifer or the Concert for Bangladesh or any of that stuff. But not always. Sometimes it's people of, you know, my own peer group, and it's always shocking to me that when people aren't aware who Leon is.
He's not the man that nobody knows. He's the man that everybody knows.
Do you remember the great movie Mad Dogs and Englishmen from the early 70s when Joe Cocker took a bunch of hippies and a million singers and musicians on the road, and it was like the first huge... Do you remember this? Am I making any sense here?
Should I remember this?
Well, of course you should.
Will it help you with this story if I remember it?
All I can say, it was the first big rock and roll movie, and the guy who pulled it all together, who made Englishmen out of the Mad Dogs, was Mr. Leon Russell, and I think that, you know, if he can't do it with us tonight, I'm going to leave show business. Thank you very much. Good night.
Who's that awesome piano player on the Stones? Or who's that guy playing on the Beach Boys? Who's that guy doing Frank Sinatra's keyboards for him?
For the longest time, you know, if you go out and somebody's, oh, well, who's your favorite artist? And it's like, Leon Russell. Who? Well, you heard of Tightrope.
I'm up on a tight wire. One side's ice and one is fire. It's a circus game with you and me.
Well, maybe, but remember, like, The Temptations, a song for you, George Benson's This Masquerade.
Searching but not finding, understanding anyway. We're lost in this masquerade.
Oh, yeah, okay, he wrote those, The Carpenters. Superstar and stuff. They know him through writing this other stuff.
I'd like to do a Leon Russell song for you now, man. A lot of guts to do this when this man's standing next to you, but I got a lot of guts. Well, I've been a lot of places in my lifetime. And I've sung a lot of songs and I've made bad rhymes. Acted out my love in stages with 10,000 people watching. Now we're alone and I am singing my song for you.
There are just, you know, up-tempo, happy songs that he writes.
Sweet Home Chicago. That song just puts me in a funky mood, and you just want to get to grooving a little bit. And
there are deeply spiritual songs that he writes.
In the darkest hour, on the blackest night, something's wrong. Nothing's right, and the hurt so strong.
There's always been a spiritual thread. It's been a thread of love through Leon's music. He's got a lot of love woven into the lyric and into the melodies of his song, and they just infect everybody, you know, as they go out, and you just feel it.
The gospel sound and the gospel rock and the things that he alludes to in a lot of his songs, that's just another thing that's part of the magic that was Leon.
He's able to say things that I feel that I don't have the talent to put into words and music.
You know, and then I tend to play his music, according to my feelings. Now, since I've been with my husband, with Steven, I play Leon and Mary a lot. I mean, it's just, and I'm constantly singing the love songs to him, and he's, you know, he's holding his ears and stuff.
I do have a favorite Leon Russell song on every album that he's ever put out. Stranger in a Strange Land, and Manhattan Island Serenade, and then there's Back to the Island. It depends on where I'm at, you know, mentally or physically, you know, what I'm feeling like.
You know, for every mood, there's something that everybody can get into.
It's hard to put down just one. I like From Maine to Mexico.
But I can't put on a CD or an LP and say, you know, that's my all-time favorite Leon Russell song. But just as soon as I said that, Jumpin' Jack Flash comes to mind. But see, that's my favorite song from, you know, about 70, 71, 72, and then 73, 74, I was a different, I had matured into a different person. So then there's, there's Stop All That Jazz. And
but there's nothing of Leon's that I don't like. And that's being very prejudiced.
There's something in Leon's lyrics. I don't know what wellspring he draws from, but I have yet to play any Leon Russell song for somebody that doesn't glean something from those lyrics that's deeply meaningful to them.
Leon Russell is kind of a genius that's able to express feelings that we all share in music and words and just in his spirit. And that's what sort of has bonded us.
But he is in a league above all the rest of the rock and roll art. And I've met a bunch of them over the years. And there's no one that thinks like he does and has his talent. I don't want his name in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. I want a wing in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. I mean, there should be a Leon Russell wing. If we have to raise the money over 10 years to donate it, and it should be dedicated to all the people from that, from no man's land, that changed the way music was heard, just the way he changed the way rock and roll was heard from the early 60s on.
He's had such a big influence on all kinds of music.
He's worked with Eric Clapton, but then he's also worked with Frank Sinatra. So, I mean, you're going to catch a fan somewhere that they're going to like something that he did. Maybe he didn't sing it, but he most likely played on it, or he arranged it or produced it or whatever. So, I mean, he touches a lot more things than a lot of people even know.
People that appreciate Leon Russell appreciate music, and they know music. I mean, they know the quality, you know, of music and the hard work that goes into it. And,
Now, like my mother, she listened to Leon. She's like, well, she thought he was pretty good, and you know, but she didn't see all the hoopla. And then Rick T had taped his Hymns of Christmas, and she is in love with O Holy Night. And she's like, well, that's my favorite, and he does that so beautifully. He says, he really is a musician. I'm like, that's what I've been trying to tell you all this time. You know, so he strikes a little bit of everything, and that's what I like.
And I think also what kept me interested was that he went really quiet, and he kind of, in a way, opted out of the big, really artificial fame thing, and I respected him for that, I think, in a way. I mean, there might be, he's probably got all sorts of reasons why that happened, and that's his business, but it seemed to me that he did turn his back on it to some extent, and I respected that.
He just signed a thing with Warner Brothers at what that time was the biggest upfront money ever given an artist. One of those mind-boggling things on the cover of all, you know, Variety and Billboard, you know, the first big And he delivers the wedding album, and they didn't want it. Well, that's fine, but we want Leon. Well, this is Leon, and Leon to give their money back. This is what I do. And that, I think, was a lot of the, you know, that beginning of that alienation.
And I loved how Leon, I still love to see him do this, how he put somebody else out there in front and lets them be the in the spotlight, and sits back, even with all his talent and all his genius, the humility of sitting back and letting them be in the spotlight. He loves it, you can tell.
have mercy. They don't help old buried none. Lord have mercy. They don't see their buried none. Looking at the blood in my body.
You never know. You can't ever predict. Just as sure as you think Leon's going to do one thing, he's going to do the other. He's the systematically most unpredictable person on the planet. It will always be on his terms, on his time.
Speaking of the Newgrass Revival, they used to play with Leon Russell for about 3 or 4 years in the late 70s, early 80s, and they made a great record that I just love, and that was sort of the inspiration for me wanting to do Valley Road Bluegrass. They should take everything, just all Leon's songs, and just play them just as fast as they could. And it was a scream to me. I loved it.
You know, I have so many people come up to me and they say, Leon, how come it is you don't do Jumpin' Jack Flash anymore? I'm going to do it for you this evening. Let's do it real close and not even recognize it. Sammy, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1. I'm on the phone. Crossed by a hurricane, and I howled at my mama in the driving rain. It's all right now.
It's all right now.
Banshee's the gas. It's all right now.
It's all right now.
I'm jumping that Banshee's the gas, gas, gas.
And they don't get it. They just don't get it. And sometimes I've wondered, does he do it out of boredom? Till that one came on. But remember, there was Leon and the Gap Band.
Look here. Well, I'm smashed, like I've gone and done it. I'm crazy, I think I slipped right on it. You know, I'm tempted, faded, it's getting late. And I'm real, do my mind is spinning. I'm trill, the other side is winning. Before you count me out, let me try to tell you what it is all about.
And then the country and western Leon.
Oh, listen to jingle, rumble and roll. Glide along the land on the hills and by the shore. Hear the mighty brother wind down and low whistle call. Sandwich cannon taken on Wabash Cannonball.
The thing about Leon is that he's so damn creative. It's like Leon's always been in music school, too. I mean, we all learn as we go. And somehow, boy, the music industry didn't like that, did they?
Back then when... You know, I thought country music was beneath me. You know, my mother would have it on in the kitchen sometime, and I'd go, how do you listen to that? But Leon planted those seeds, and I listened to it because it was Leon with Hank Wilson's back album.
Hear that lonesome wheel. He sounds too blue to fly.
And then even years later, as those seeds he planted started to grow, I opened up to a whole new realm of music. And actually, when I've got the radio on, I listen to country music these last 10 years. I listen to country music most of the time. But it opened my eyes up to be able to appreciate all kinds of music.
I had never really heard black gospel music before. He featured Black Grass, which was Reverend Patrick Henderson and the girls that sang behind Leon.
Also from Dallas is a Reverend Patrick Henderson on the other piano. I'm going to feature Patrick in the choir right now on a good gospel song. It's called Great Day.
So I ended up getting into gospel music, too.
I love the Hank Wilson, you know, the thing that he does with the country twang. You know, I love the gospel rock part of it. I like that boogie-woogie. And
thank you all for coming out to see us in Charlotte tonight. I really appreciate it. And from time to time, we're going to try to bring you some good gospel music and other kinds of music that you might not ever have seen before.
Leon is a, what do they call it? In a work in progress. The Leon Russell music thing is a work in progress.
It's a special kind of person, I think, that appreciates Leon Russell.
I've always thought Leon has never had the kudos he deserved for what he's done for music.
It's just a real love and respect and appreciation for this guy that is so talented, that had the courage to do things his way.
And it's so lucky because he had the chance in that first arc of fame and fortune to do what everybody else did. Become the overnight sensation, make trillions of dollars, and do it their way. And Leon always refused that. Pissed a lot of people off. But Leon's always done it his way. And you now see where he was right, because the best is yet to come.
I mean, there are thousands or hundreds of thousands of Leon Russell fans out there, but I think we've gone a step further, if you will, almost to fanatic.
And right after I found out that I lost my job, we found out Leon was going to be playing in a little club there, two shows. So we scraped together what money we had and bought two tickets each for the two shows.
And, both shows.
Yeah, made sure we did that. You know, we'd worry about groceries
eating
after that.
Later.
I have Leon Russell posters and tickets that I've had signed, and duplicate albums and duplicate CDs. Before CDs, I mean, I've worn out Leon Russell albums.
Every time I go to a record store, I go to
the R's.
R. And
straight
if they don't have
R's.
Any Leon Russell, I go tell them that they need to get some in there. A lot of times they don't. They do here now in Louisville.
They do in Bloomington too.
And the radio station, the public radio station, plays him too. Or if they didn't, I would never contribute any money to them.
So anybody knows that to buy me a gift, it's like, okay, something by Leon. Call her and find out what exactly she wants, because she probably has it. You know, so I just make it known that he's my favorite artist of all time.
We don't go to the movies. We don't go out to dinner much, you know, and pretty much we have teenage daughters, so our lives on weekends and stuff are pretty much taken up with that. So we just save up for our Leon concerts, and that's our time together.
When Stephen and I got married, it was Leon Russell music. You know, there's a party or something, there's Leon music. When I'm feeling certain ways or whatever, I go and listen to his music. Not so much that it's gonna solve my problems, but damn it makes me feel better about doing things.
I mean, the highlight of my day is coming home and putting on a Leon Russell CD. You know, when I get off work, it's just great.
I've seen him a lot, you know, to the point where I've not only, you know, memorized the sets, but memorized, you know, the notes to the song, you know, what's coming and that kind of thing.
Then we've seen him, I guess, since then, I don't know, 60 or 70 times probably, all over the place, from Pennsylvania to Tulsa to
New Orleans
to
California,
Florida,
New York.
Because it's not really about what usually happens when people have someone that they watch and follow, like a musician, which we do. But there was a lot more going on with this than just being fans.
Each one of you seemed to have some sort of epiphanal experience in your life that Leon's music was a part of. And each person was different, and I've loved hearing those.
I was about 15 years old, and I had the coolest aunt. She was 7 years older than me and was really more like a big sister than an aunt. And she introduced me to Leon, and she and I used to always kid about, you know, we'd just like to get him and set him up and make him sing in a room for us sometime, you know. So she took me to see him several times, and
The first time we went to see him was at the first Willie Nelson's picnic in Texas on the 4th of July that lasted for 3 days at the Texas World Speedway. And I was going because I knew Leon was going to be there. And she told me it was going to be a great time. And then when we get there and I see the bill for this and people like Kinky Friedman and Lefty Frizzell and Doug Somm. And at that time, you know, like I said, I had just turned 16 then, and it was like, this is going to be the worst time of my life. You know, all these country people, because here I was, you know, a rock and roll girl, I thought. And we got there, and I don't think I ever sat down the whole 3 days. I was probably about 4 or 5 months pregnant at that time, and I think I danced solid from the time we got up in the morning until we went to bed at night. And so the second day, I think, is when I decided I was going to name my baby Leon Russell, you know, because right around that time I had felt him move, and it was kind of like a significant thing of it happening there, you know, and it happened to be just one of the greatest times of my life.
His music has just touched our hearts and got us through so many things over 30 years. I mean, happiness and sadness and crying and joy and marriage and birth. And
last year, my husband passed away in March, and he was also a big Leon fan. And one of the reasons that we were as happy together as we were, because we shared things like that. Our first date was a Leon concert. And at our wedding, we played Leon's song. I mean, our whole lives were interwoven with his music.
I remember especially going to a cabin kind of place, a mountain retreat, and having the fire crackle, and it was an autumn day, you know, it was a crisp Pennsylvania autumn day, and we spent the day listening to Leon, and it was just great. And sometimes when I hear certain songs, it reminds me of that, you know.
When I had been going through a really hard time, Anything Can Happen came out.
Anything can happen right here and now. From the very bottom to the highest cloud. Just keep believing and loving strong. Anything can happen.
When I heard that song, I felt as though that was exactly what I needed to hear at the time. And then shortly thereafter, my husband moved back from where he had been away. He'd moved off, and we got back together, and we married and lived very happily until last year when he passed away.
I don't know that Leon really knows how much he's done in people's lives. I mean, he's got to have some inkling. He's been doing it too long to not know or have, you know, some idea of what his music and him just living his day-to-day life have meant to people, or have, in my case, changed my life. I got to a place where, we talked about my roommate in junior college earlier. He had become a heroin addict, and I was real close to going down that road. But heard something in Leon's music. I can't tell you. I know what song it was. Manhattan Island Serenade. It opens. Sitting on the highway in a broken van. Thinking of you again. I guess I'll have to hitchhike down the highway. With every step I see your face. Like a mirror looking back at me. Saying, you're the only one. And I found a thread at that point in my life where I was sitting by the highway of life in a broken van, you know, in a life that wasn't working.
That's what made me a LeonLifer. I'll never forget, you know, how that made me feel, how the concert just thrilled me, you know, down to a, you know, so deep a place that I didn't even, you know, existed. And it's really the first time music had ever moved me to tears. And yeah, I just stood there and cried when they played. Still do.
But here was a guy who led a cadre of young people without leading. I think in his music and the things that I've read that he says about himself, he never intended to lead anyone anywhere. He was just doing what God gifted him to.
the internet. The first thing I did with my computer is type in Leon Russell.
When I first signed on to a computer, and I'm not a good typist, but I hit L-E-O-N space R-U-S-S-E-L-L, enter. It's the first thing I did. I'm not the only one, there's others.
I did that too, first time I got on the internet ever. First thing I looked up was Leon Russell, first thing.
When we first got our computer a few years ago, and since I'm not a techno guy in any stretch of the imagination, once my kid hooked it up, showed me how to find the worldwide internet, hadn't heard of Yahoo yet, hadn't heard of any of these other, you know, servers or anything, it clicked the globe, and the first thing I punched up was Leon Russell.
Yeah, we were talking last night, and basically all of us, when we got our first computer, was trying to figure out how to learn what was out there on the computer. We all typed in Leon.
Well, my girlfriend Renee, she bought me a web TV. I was recuperating. We're actually going through cancer treatments for breast cancer. And she thought it would be a nice idea to have something, you know, while I was in bed, and something to fool around with. So the first thing I did, of course, was go into Leon Russell to see what was happening there, because I did know that there were a few sites. I had no idea how many there were. And I was just fiddling around, and I was looking for a chat group, and there was nothing. So I looked under one list, and there was nothing for Leon. So it had this big thing, you know, if you want to start a group, you can. So I was like, okay, let me just start it. Nobody's going to answer it. And on, I think it was 21st of December of 98, I went ahead and started up the group. And my first person was Rick Colburn. And he just was like, hi, B-girl. You know, I'm Rick Colburn, and I've loved Leon since whenever.
The first several months, there were probably about six or seven of us. And it just kind of, and Marcia was sick at the time, and we didn't hear from her for a good while. So every once in a while, I'd just write, and it, like the emails we get now, there's so many, it wasn't like that in the early days. And I'd keep writing and try to kind of keep it going along.
And then as I was going through my treatment, I got progressively worse, of course, and I wasn't able to keep it up. So even though I started the group, Rick C. is the one that really maintained it and to make it really what it is.
Off of a Leon Russell website, I get an email from somebody, hey, why don't you join the Leon Russell one list? Well, what's the one list? So I start firing emails back and forth, find out this guy, Rick Colburn, lives not far from me. He's the Okie from Muskogee. And pretty soon, it's three people. Then it's 10 people. Then it's 12 people.
And it all of a sudden kind of started snowballing a little bit. More and more people started joining, and it really grown, and we've got about 94, 95 members now.
The way I got involved with LeonLifer, I had went to see Leon at a little town in Texas, Cypress, Texas, right outside of Houston, and I knew he had this web page, or this guy had a web page that was about Leon. So I went the next day and I posted just a note, you know, hey, saw Leon at 10 Hall last night, he was awesome as usual, you know, and I actually hopped up on stage, and, you know, so I told this little story that this sheriff came and sat by me, and he said, little lady, you do that one more time, we're going to have to kick you out of here. So, you know, I said, yes, sir, and I was good. But I wrote that on there, and then all of a sudden Rick Colburn emailed me, and he said, oh, you sound like you need to join our group, you know, come on over here and join this group. And I had no idea what I was in for, and probably as soon as you joined, about 50 emails in a row, people welcoming you, you know. Welcome, Nita. Tell us all about yourself. How did you get to love Leon?
And I didn't come up for air for several months after that. It was, you know, anything else in life was kind of I considered to be an intrusion once I found that site, you know, work and having to cook dinner and all that stuff. It was like, ah.
And then I meet this group, and it's like, I thought I was the only one that was madly in love with Leon and his music, and I found out, like, oh, I'm not the only one. And I was really surprised how deep it ran.
And it was just wonderful to find that common thread now that the internet brought us together and we were able to kind of know each other.
Suddenly found all these people, that it was just a miracle to us that, you know, all these people were writing and talking about Leon Russell online.
mean, there's 200, 250, or 100, or whatever emails daily. There's a daily dose of Leon, you know, messages posted. And that's great.
Now I get up to check my email from the one list, which can be anywhere from 40 to 260 emails a day, which, you know, my family's adapted to that. They know that's something I do. I've got friends all over the country.
The amazing thing was when I saw those posts, I said, there's got to be hundreds, if not 1,000 people in this discussion group, because who could have all of those posts? And only later found out there was like 80 or 90 people that accounted for the tens of thousands of posts. And that was probably even more amazing when I found out that there was fewer people that accounted for the totality of all that was written.
It used to be, oh, easily. I could spend, easily 20 to 30 hours a week, and most weeks probably more than that, given the opportunity. Since May, probably, it's much less than that, not by choice, but kind of, you know, I'm forced to be an adult every once in a while.
I think over the last 30 years, I knew I was a Leon nut way back when. And over the years, you get to thinking, well, I guess I'm Leon's biggest fan. But then through the internet, we found that each one of us felt the same way. We're all Leon's biggest fan.
Because I didn't think anybody could be a bigger Leon guy than me. But then when I found out that, wait a minute, these guys knew him. They knew him when he was Claude Russell Bridges, when they went to high school with him. You know, and then they got these guys that know every little thing about him. And then they got guys that are willing to put the hours into creating websites and web pages with all sorts of great information.
It's not just a music fan club anymore. They're personal friends now. Some of the stuff that goes on the list to help one another, you know, if one has a problem, you know, it's like, you know, we joke about it, but to an extent it's true, and to other people it would sound crazy, but there's a certain amount of energy amongst us all.
You know, our common love is Leon, but we all became friends, and it's like, oh, well, Marcia's not feeling good today, she had a setback, whatever. And then I'm getting all these I love you emails, and we're praying for you. Roberta from England sent me flowers, you know. So it's become really a family of sorts.
We met on the internet, not knowing each other. We have felt out who we were, and they're some of the finest, I mean, not some, but the finest people I've
we're
ever met.
We're a family now.
Just.
We love each other.
Just in terms of just sharing and caring and just good qualities, and it's something that we can relate to.
I mean, we relate better to each other, I think, than we relate to people that we know or live with or whatever all the time.
It's a lot easier sometimes to tell people your troubles and your joys without having to look them in the face for the first time. And we've had some heart-wrenching and some touching and, you know, all kinds of news shared on this list. So we felt like we knew each other way before we ever met each other.
We know everybody, who everybody's husband and wife is. We know their kids' names. We even know when people's dogs get sick. I mean, it's just like a family type situation.
We all let each other know what's going on in our lives, and it's just fantastic.
It's a nice group of people.
It really is, and it feels like you've known them a long time.
It's family. It's felt like family from the beginning.
And as soon as I joined, I instantly found people that were just like me and people that I felt that I'd known forever.
And almost immediately felt like we were part of some family. It was just remarkable, the kind of connection that we got with those people right off the bat.
You know, it's a news group that's turned into a family.
We are family. There's not a doubt. Yeah, we are family.
Yeah, it is very much like a family. It's a wonderful thing.
This is a unusual group in that really nobody knows anybody. I mean, some people know people from different areas, but nobody knows anybody yet. It seems like we know everybody. It seems like we have the same traits, the same feelings, the same heart, the same drive. You know, to have something in common with a couple people on the internet that you don't know, I mean, that's, I would say that that happens. You know, that's not a rare, unique thing. But to have a whole list of people, guys and chicks, women, chicks, it's so unusual, and it's so great. It's so great because we're talking about a guy that a lot of us have seen for, you know, 30 years. Yet you can mention something that you've been thinking about that happened, you know, way back when, and people can relate to it.
Most of these people, there's an immediate bonding, and I feel like I've known them my whole life. And I think that part of that is we've sung the same songs in different states, not ever having met each other. And that's all due to this man, Leon Russell, that he put something out there that I recognized in 69 through a song that brought something welling up that was locked inside me, opened a door, however, you know, whatever analogy you want to put on it. And we all were hit by that same chord.
Leon's the heart, obviously, of it all. And that heart's grown now, and those hearts are now amongst the people.
It's really hard to explain. I didn't know Rick C. from anybody. I didn't know these people. And it just struck me that these people cared about what, you know, what's happening with me.
If somebody doesn't check in and they're gone for the weekend and we don't hear from them, we're kind of wondering where they are and why they didn't tell us they were leaving.
I didn't write for a couple of weeks one time, and finally Linda Lou emailed me directly and she said, "The list is screaming your name. Where are you? We're worried. You know, you haven't posted in 2 weeks. Are you okay?" And so now every time I leave to go out of town, you know, I say bye for now or on the road again, or this one I think was let's go to Memphis in the meantime, baby. So
of course, you know, the personalities get into it, and a relative or something is sick, and then you find out kind of who's religious and who's not, if they're sending vibes or prayers or whatever.
We come together and we, you know, say I need a prayer for so-and-so, or I need a prayer for so-and-so, because there's been a lot of us, like, you know, have discovered illnesses that they didn't know they had, or came down with some sort of serious ailment, you know, that and we pray for each other.
This has been one thing that's been really great, is that when people have had to face sickness or illness or their family, we'll write and say, "Hey, would y'all pray for me?" You know, and there's, in the way people believe, I mean, there's a wide range of beliefs and people's different spiritualities, but we still, sure, you know, we'll pray for you, we'll keep you in our thoughts, whatever.
I got a phone call from Rick Colburn's wife that Rick was going in the hospital. And then I saw on the list that he was going in, had a problem with his heart. And he was going in for surgery, and he was going into a hospital in Tulsa. And my son was, I was reading it out loud. My son, who's 16, a very wise 16-year-old, said, "Daddy, what are we going to do?" I said, "What do you mean?" He said, "Well, your buddy's going to the hospital."
I had to have angioplasty. And they went in, did the balloon thing, and Steve Burns came and visited me in the hospital.
We walked in, and his mom, Honey, and his wife are there, and Rick's laying in the bed, and they were just aghast.
But, you know, when he walked in the door, I knew who he was from his pictures, and then, you know, we'd talked for so long.
I'd never seen Rick face to face. I'd never seen a picture of him. But when I walked in a room, there was an immediate bond. It was a kinship. I felt as if I'd known Rick since high school.
It meant a whole lot when Steve came to see me in the hospital.
We've grown to the place where we're not just people who share a common interest in a musician or in a type of music, but we're a family. We've had people who had financial problems, and somebody would off list send an email to everybody on the list except the person who had the problem. You know, if you can send $5 or $10 or $20 or, you know, whatever you can afford. We've got a brother who's having a rough time. And in a matter of a day, put together $500 or $600 and send it to somebody, again, that we've never met before in our lives.
That's been an interesting phenomenon to me. I just never would have believed that before this, that people from such disparate backgrounds, much of the time, who have never really met in person before, would be so quick to rally behind someone else in need.
Having somebody stand beside you, and that's kind of one of the things about the one list. It's like we stand beside each other. We're there with each other when anything goes bad. And we're there when things go good, too. We talked about, boy, what if we could all get together somewhere? And should we go to an already planned Leon concert?
We were talking online one day, and somebody said, you know, we ought to just have our own Leon Russell concert. And a light went on.
I thought it was a pipe dream. It's like, it sounded nice. I think somebody said that if they had won a lot, there was a big lottery, I believe, was going on. And a couple people said, oh, if I won the lottery, we would fly all the LeonLifers to a location, have a private show.
I think we thought we were arranging a fantasy, you know, and then all of a sudden it no longer was a fantasy.
Because he did say he would cooperate with us. We got him to say
we asked him about that at a concert in Chicago a year before. Would he do a concert for us? You know, the lifers, you know, we told him who we were, a group of people that had been following his music for 30 years. And he said, if you get a venue, and we go, okay.
We tried to look ahead at the dates and the times.
Kathleen from Australia says, I need to get out of Australia during the Olympics. I'm coming to the U.S. Roberta says, hey, I can come there that time. So we picked late last week of September, first week of October.
So that's how it got to be September the 28th.
Started focusing on that. We kicked around, where can we have it? Some people said Texas. Some people said Oklahoma. They said, no, we got the birthday bash there. Different spots. The consensus was Tennessee, since it's close to his home.
So he wouldn't have far to go. We thought, well, if he'll come and do this concert for us, we don't want him to go far. So let's have it in Nashville.
Nothing happened.
Mary Nell had seen Leon at the club here.
Mary Nell finally says, hey, I know somebody. I've got a good friend that knows somebody at Coyote's. Next thing you know, our other lifer friends say, well, go for it, which we did. She came all the way down. We tried to do the phone call route, and it took probably 2 or 3 weeks, actually, before we made contact.
They put the wheels in motion and started talking to Leon's people. Daryl talked to the people here at Coyote's.
They were very cynical, very, you guys are full of it, you know, just, I mean, nice and everything, but weren't really... they didn't want to have our bubble burst, and they were saying, you know, don't think you're going to be able to. He doesn't care anything about you guys or this kind of stuff.
He doesn't care anything about you.
You know, they just come in on their bus and they go, and they've got other fans, and it was real cynical.
Well, it turned out that the amount of money that we had to come up with was in the $4,000 or $5,000 range, and the first thing that struck me when I read that was, we can't make this happen. $4,000 or $5,000.
There were times it looked like, well, it was just going to fall through, but we kept after it. Mary Nell kept after it, and Daryl.
We ran in stumbling blocks. We talked though, and we just felt like it was going to happen. We didn't know it was going to happen. We just felt like it was.
Then somebody did the math and divided the figure by the number of lifers that were on the list at that point in time. And the tickets came out to be $80 a piece.
But she is, I never saw a crack in her belief that it wasn't going to happen.
It was going to happen. Anything can happen, as Leon says.
I didn't think long. And this is not something that I do all the time, but I just wrote a check, put it in an envelope, stamped it, and sent it to Mary Nell Shiflett in Indiana. And after the check was in the mail, I was aghast. I don't even do that when I bid on eBay. I don't give my credit card information or anything. I'll send a money order. You tell me who to send a money order to, and I'll trust you to ship it because we have an intermediary. Well, there's no intermediary here.
except the good feelings we had as family.
That was the feeling for the whole group, really, after especially after it got going. And it didn't matter either if it didn't happen. We were going to go forward with the money, with the place, so that it could, if there was any chance. If people didn't get their money back, they said it was okay.
But where everybody's, yeah, we're going, and plunking down the $80 per ticket, it's like, you know, it's no problem. They want to get together.
It had to be exciting for Mary Nell and Dina, who wasn't able to come. She was our treasurer, to get these checks from all over the world.
All over the world. Everybody sent money. I mean, to someone off the internet. But, you know, we had that bond from Leon and his music, and we knew that everything was going to be okay, and nobody's check bounced. We raised a lot of money for this and paid for a lot of things, everybody. There were some people that couldn't afford to buy a ticket. Others bought tickets for them.
All of a sudden, we had booked Leon. We had booked Coyotes. It was coming together.
And then all of a sudden, it no longer was a fantasy. But I got to the stage where I was so worried that I might not get to this fantasy here.
You know, there's just no question. Just had to come.
And we knew we were going to be a part of it. We signed up early because we knew we were going to have to be a part of that.
There was never any question whether or not I was going to come. It was, how am I going to get there and how long am I going to stay? You know, there was never any question. And everybody thought I was nuts, but, I mean, you're going to do what? You're going where?
Yeah, I have several friends that have kind of wondered about me.
My husband and probably quite a few of my acquaintances think I'm completely nuts for traveling all over the country to meet up with people that I met via the internet, all for the love of Leon.
Sharing a room with a guy I've never met before in my life. Just, he's kind of a lurker on the one list. He hides back and reads all the digest and once in a while throws a zinger or a comment out there. And he was sharing with me last night, Bill Page, that his daughter said, well, now, Dad, wait a minute. You're flying to Louisville, Kentucky. You're going to be with a group of people you've never met. Isn't this what you tell me not to do on the internet?
Like I say, I just can't believe we're actually here still yet. It's like a nice dream.
This group has been waiting so long for this event, and, you know, everybody got here, I guess, that was planning to. And all the hard part's been taken care of, getting the venue and securing the date for Leon to play and everyone making their travel arrangements. So now it's just time to kick back and enjoy it. And we will.
Well, the closer we got, we picked up Suzanne in Memphis, so we had a very good road trip in that day, and we've rocked with Leon on the way here, and I think the excitement building up to know that we were on our way here to meet so many of these people that had come so far for this event. I mean, of course, the show and Leon was the ultimate, but getting to meet everybody finally, you know, because we already, like I said, we already all feel like we know each other, and that was just the final capper, really, when going to that room that night and having people recognize you, you know, and everybody hugging and everybody sharing stories, and it was just awesome.
It was amazing to the connection and the friendship and the love that was there. Just, you know, I hadn't met these people face to face before, and it was almost as if we'd known each other all our lives.
There are people that I met here in Louisville that I've only talked to on the list. Marsha Belinsky, the woman who started it. I saw her for the first time last night. And as soon as I saw her, I knew who she was before I even heard her name.
I'm really excited about seeing Leon. You know, I really want to see him real bad, but the highlight is meeting all these people. And the people that I've, you know, I've, the only person I talked to on the phone was Rick. I'm surprised at the different drawls and the little southern twangs going on and everything, but I'm finally meeting all these different people, and it's wonderful.
We got brought together by Leon, but these friendships, and you know, it's just amazing, you know, to get to see these people for the first time.
I felt like I knew everybody. I mean, I got just the boisterous bear hugs I expected.
I was kind of, you know, not leery, but I was kind of wondering how it was going to be, you know, meeting such a large group of those, not strangers, but people you've never met, you know, just talked to online. But there was, it felt like family right off the bat, you know?
Yeah, it's funny because we've said that in our posts on the web. You know, you talk about how it feels like family and everything, but it really does when you get here and you see, I mean, we see people and you go, you know, they have on a name tag, oh, you're so-and-so and you're so-and-so, and you just hug and it's like you've known each other for a long time. Because we all have that common interest and common love for Leon and his music, so it's just easy to come together. You feel like old friends.
I told my employer I'm going to be gone this weekend. He said, where are you going? I told him this 8 or 9 months ago before it was a solidified deal, that I'm going to a reunion. He said, a family reunion. Yeah. It's a reunion of a family.
And when we did get together, it wasn't like just meeting faceless people on the internet. I mean, we knew each other. It was like a family reunion.
We already kind of knew each other, you know, because we've, you know, talked many times about our deepest feelings and needs. But when you put a face, you know, with somebody, that really deepens the bond.
But I have to say that the event was far more than I could have expected in all respects, getting to meet the people and seeing real people rather than words on an internet screen. It was a great experience.
You know, you can really come to love somebody's sense of humor when you're reading their online comments, and you can't help but really want to get to know that person for real, you know, instead of just these online comments. So it hasn't really been a surprise, but it's been a great treat getting to meet all these people.
To me, it's a dream come true, not only to have these people on the list, but to have the opportunity and to be able to be here and meet these people. It was just a great joy, and there was, I wouldn't have missed this for the world. And I was lucky and fortunate enough to be able to get here.
Is one of our lifers was coming to the show, always has. She's an original member. And all of a sudden, she couldn't make it because she got laid off at work. And she just couldn't afford the traveling. She had the tickets. And I was heartbroken about that and tried to persuade her to come. And she said, if I can get there, I will, but I can't see it happening. This was up to last week.
And I just couldn't see how I could come. I mean, you know, if you're out of work, you really need to stay home. But when I finally posted to everyone that I just couldn't make it, immediately I began being bombarded, and I mean bombarded, with people saying, oh, no, ma'am, you're coming. We don't care what we have to do, but you're coming.
The next thing I heard, it's got round amongst the lifers that this is happening, that someone now has detoured out of their way to pick this person up. You know, that person has to be there.
So Nita and Gary from Houston drove through Memphis and picked me up. Pat and Alan Hoppy, the one that made the ribbons, have paid for my room. Mary Nell gave me a ticket. People have bought me dinner. People have bought me drink. I mean,
if it can possibly or physically be done, it will be done. You know, especially where Leon is concerned.
This just doesn't happen for just anybody. You know, how blessed am I to be part of this group? I'll never be able to thank people enough for what they've given me, which is love.
We have fallen in love with each other. We have become truly brothers and sisters, united, like we said earlier, by a common thread.
Ambrose was able to tell me something, and I related to him. He told me that she was my sister, and he was my brother, and that's what it's about. And that's why we're here. We don't know. I can't explain it.
I can't either.
You know, Leon has one of his lyrics says, "Never treat a brother like a passing stranger." We preach that as a society. We practice it as a family.
These are the kind of fans that he has. These are the people that he has brought together and created a family out of. This is what his life's work has done.
But when I look at the family of people that's come together over the internet, the lifers, all you got to do is just go look at them. You don't have to say anything about Leon Russell. But you go down to the lobby and stand back and just look at the lifers. And these are people, like I said before, who've never met each other other than with a few keystrokes on the internet. But they bond so quickly, and you can see a love, you can see a light there.
You know, I'll keep this with me forever, and I think there's a bond here that, you know, people are going to come and go, but this bond, which was as strong as it could get before we all met, it's going to be even stronger.
The thread that holds this necklace together, this beautiful, multifaceted, multicolored, incredible work, the thread's Leon Russell. So that really is what a lifer is.
But there was no guarantee that he would say hi or hello, or we didn't know.
We were just hoping he'd come and let us shower him with our love and our gifts and, you know, that we wanted to present to him. And
People kept thinking, well, we get a chance to see him and talk. We don't know. It's up to him.
I was one of the ones with a few of the others that said, I don't want to push. Because a few people saying, let's get Leon together and we'll all have our photograph taken with him. And I said, he won't do that. If we say to him, that's what we want you to do, he won't do that in a fit. I mean, he'll run a mile, wouldn't you? Because we kind of get an idea of what his personality's like. And he's not all that keen on, we know, on lots of people sort of rushing around. So I voted for, and others did too, that we just don't ask for anything.
The one memory I think I'll remember is I was lucky enough to be standing out in the hall when he came to visit us yesterday. Yeah, you were too.
Yeah, I was too. Yeah.
There were just a few people out there, and of course he arrived unannounced. And he came in, and as he was coming in, he was on his scooter and had his hat on and his sunglasses, you know. There he was, Leon Russell, and he comes just strolling in all by himself, you know. And we just went, oh!
And Leon, he was cool, like he's always cool.
Well, y'all sit down, you're making me nervous.
He said, I'll never forget it. He said, I had to come over because I heard Elvis was going to be here.
Yep. And he just says, hi, everybody. And we're going, oh, my gosh.
His cell phone rang and he goes, Elvis?
Yeah, he did.
I'll never forget that as long as I live.
You will not disappoint people. You may only get 10% of the man on the piano, but he is there. Come hell or high water. When he got out of the hospital recently, it blew me away that he left the hospital and went to St. Louis to do a couple of gigs. I went, what are you doing? And the doctors, I think, even said, no, you need to stay home and get some rest. And he was back. Hey, he just won't do that. He shows up. And when he knew that you all expected him, he showed up. And did he ever? Did he ever?
I hope I don't get up here and die on you.
He let people touch him and tell him how much we love him and what his music has meant to each one of us. And he signed autographs and he spent time with everyone.
What was fun to see is that he had time for everybody, he really did. He listened to him, he talked to him, and individually reacted to them. So.
And he was very generous with his time. It was
he took a genuine interest in what each and every person had to say and a little bit about what their story was. I mean, he didn't just, hi, nice to meet you, next, you know, which I've met some celebrities that do that. It was just so heartfelt.
But for him to come so completely voluntarily and to just sit around with everyone, it worked out absolutely perfectly as far as I feel. It meant that he knew that we didn't demand it, that we didn't expect it, that we weren't insisting on it. It was I mean, he just did it because he wanted to. Yeah, and I thought that was really lovely.
And as it turns out, it was a way for him to give us a gift. So he was able to come and give us this gift of coming over to see us in our room.
Our welcome room.
Our welcome room, and spent a lot of time.
The fact he came down before the show and visited with all of us for 2 hours plus, I mean, I don't know if anybody knew that was going to, you know, transpire. And just so gracious and so real. And for a lot of us who think we know him, but to really experience him, you know, up close and personal like that, it was a great experience.
So, you know, you need to stop and think. You need to trust your heart, trust your mind. Preachers and dictators will take you down to Guyana and beyond if you don't watch them. So, you know, people, the road to hell is paved with a bunch of bad preachers, you know what I mean?
And I was listening to him, and so I told somebody downstairs, I haven't heard that timbre in his voice for 30 years. In fact, it was 30 years ago this month. And he played a thing at Hissom Center in Tulsa 30 years ago for crippled children. And he had that same timbre in his voice yesterday when he was talking to you guys. And I knew, bingo, it's real. It's real.
Let me start by telling you this other story, which is kind of interesting. I saw this on TV. A guy was working on Planet of the Apes. He said he noticed a weird thing when he's working on that movie. They stop and eat. There's three kinds of monkeys in that movie. There's orangutans, chimps, and gorillas. When they stop and eat, he got to noticing that the gorilla sat at one table, the orangutan sat at one table, and the chimp sat at one table. I suddenly realized that we all got monkey suits on of one kind or another, but we're all somebody else underneath there. Yeah. So I wanted to tell you about this hair. What happened, why I got this hair, is because I realized that one day I went to a Frank Sinatra session. And I had one of these Sebring haircuts, you know, first time I went down with
him. We've got every picture. We've seen them all, Leon. We've seen them all.
When I first got my first Sebring haircut, I went out and looked at myself in the mirror for 30 minutes in the car because it wasn't sticking up. So I always had one of those kind of hairs, but you had to spray it down. It was a lacquered kind of deal. It was like a helmet almost. So one day, I went to a Frank Sinatra session, and I didn't have time to fix my hair and spray it down. It's getting a little bit long, and it's hanging down a little bit. All these people, the same people that I work with every day, all my friends, came up and dumped all this hideous animosity on me.
Oh my God.
Because my hair was hanging down. Yeah. I thought, what is this? You know, the world looked the same to me that day as it did the previous day. So I was coming, me and Rita Coolidge was coming back from Memphis, Tennessee. I was bringing a car back. It was in Oklahoma, a place was in the middle of the country. There was a gas station. We stopped and I went and used the restroom, came back, getting ready to leave. A little black family. That was wanted to use the restroom. And the guy said, oh, you can't use our restroom, it's broke. And I just thought, you know, I always want to look this way to see who my friends are.
It was nice to see that he is just a nice person. You know, He's not affected or anything at all. He's just a nice person doing his thing, and we happen to enjoy his thoughts and the way he puts it in music, and he just, it's great.
And the way he just embraced us as family, you know, yesterday I got to sit down and have my first conversation with him, you know. Yesterday I got to flirt with him, and he flirted back. And it was great. I'll never forget it.
And it's like, you know, this is like the ultimate fan thing, like on MTV or something, where, you know, you meet your idol.
Well, I met Leon yesterday for the first time. I've never had the nerve. I couldn't possibly go up and meet him before. But Dana Jo, another member who also said, you're coming regardless, she took me by the hand, tears streaming down my face, and made me meet him, which I'll never forget.
And getting to meet him yesterday was just, oh my God. I never thought that I would get to be that close, because I know now he's such a private person, you know, and I never thought it was gonna happen. And my heart was beating and my hands were shaking. And what was really funny is when I did get to talk to him, I told him that I had a son that was fixing to be 26 that I named Leon Russell. And he said, oh, really, do you have a picture of him with you? And I swear I looked at pictures of my son to bring with me just in case. And I told Leon that. I said, but I didn't think I would ever get this close to you to tell you that. And, you know, he kind of laughed. He said, well, you know, I am a little bit shy these days. And, you know, it's like, yeah, just a little bit. But we were really, all of us, just in hog heaven yesterday. I mean, we couldn't have asked for anything better.
Somebody downstairs said, and it's true, this exceeds the fantasy just 100 times.
Let's step inside and it's been raining all day since you went away. And had not a serenade.
All right, now all you choir members out on the bus.
It just doesn't get any better than this. You don't get to have a contact like this with your idol and them be better than you imagine them to be, them not be disappointing, to be just what you want them to be and more. I mean, that's just got to be the pinnacle.
But tonight, anyway, before the concert, provided everything works out, Leon is supposed, there's a room in the back of Coyote's that we're supposed to go, and Marinelle invited a number of friends of Leon to come join us.
Ambrose and Miss Emily.
Reverend Patrick Henderson.
Reverend Patrick Henderson.
We were able
the
to get all of
these
friends.
You know, we've known Ambrose for several years now and gotten close with him, and he has talked a lot about his brother Leon, and he shared things about the years that he's been, the 20-some years that he was with Leon. And
thank you very much. I want to introduce the band to you right now, just in case you don't know who everybody is. We've got a brand new member back there in the back hiding behind the conga drums. He's from Nigeria, on the continent of Africa. He just celebrated his 54th birthday just a while back. It's Mr. Ambrose Campbell on the conga drum.
And we have become a family. I mean, he loves me dearly, and I love him dearly. And since I've come into this country, you know, in 72, and he has sheltered me and protected me.
We got to know Leon kind of through Ambrose and got to know the man, besides the artist, besides the musical genius. And then to have Ambrose be a part of it was really powerful.
A small group like this, look what it done. You bring everything. We haven't seen Patrick. The last time I saw Patrick was 73, 74.
One of the highlights for me was for Patrick to be able to come, and I kind of undertook to find Patrick. You know, when I heard that this was going to happen, I just felt, you know, deep in my heart that he needed to be here, and so I looked him up and arranged for him to come. And
before I left to come here, my godson said to me, he says, where are you going? And I said, I'm going to to be with actually the progenitor of the beginning of my career. And he said, is that Leon Russell? I said, yes. And he said, so you getting ready to go back out on the road? I said, no. That wasn't mentioned to me. I'm just going to see Leon. And Melissa, is Melissa here? Is she not? There she is. Raise your hand, Melissa.
Melissa
tracks me now. This is starting. Yeah. In March of this year, I got this call at my church and it said, this lady says she's been following you your whole life. I got scared. It says that she remembered me from playing with Leon. To make a long story short, I have to tell you that 30 years since we've been together, I'm 51 years old, and I was young, and it was the first time actually I had gone from church to the rock and roll stage. And in a period of those, I guess, 4 to 5 years that I was with Leon, I learned so much. Not only did he start calling me Reverend, but he actually chose what God had already chosen for me. Yeah. To call me Reverend. My father was a minister, but I had no intentions of becoming a preacher. And last year, I preached my initial sermon. Just last year. Yeah. This is a very special time that we've been called together. The reason for that, we're not sure why, but we know that there is a lot of love, there's a lot of joy, there's a lot of looking at each other and seeing what's missing, like hair, teeth, eyes laying over on the nightstand. But we're still here, we're home. And I feel that the reason that we are here is to not only let Leon know who and what he's been in our lives, but mostly to glorify God and to thank him for the opportunity to come together and say thank you. I just want to say to Leon, I've been talking to him all day, we've been talking, that not only have you been an instrument of change and an instrument of good in my life, but I get the feeling that everybody here feels the same way.
I was so pleased when he made Ambrose a part of that and Patrick could be a part of it.
Well, Emily and Leon have been like best friends for probably about 35 years now.
Like, I don't remember a day I didn't know Leon. Somebody said, when did you first meet Leon? I don't remember when. It's like I always knew Leon. I don't remember a time not knowing Leon.
First time I ever got to see who she was in the Mad Dogs and Englishmen movie. Several songs that, you know, pretty much about a certain lady, but the one song that he said her name right up front was Sweet Emily, and it's the most beautiful love song. I mean, it would be a tribute to any lady to have a song like that written about you.
The lady I know, and I'm lucky to see, she's a woman in every way. Oh, she weeps just like a widow when the hate is clouding up my day. Yes, it does. And when she touches my eye, take my heart in her hand. If you knew that child, you plainly see. Whoa. I realize I'm in love with my sweet Emily.
Well, it's weird when somebody knows who you are and they think I'm some wonderful person because Leon wrote a song in the middle of the night years ago. And it's kind of put you on a pedestal and then you kind of go, ooh, that's, you know, believe me, I'm as real as you guys are, just the same.
Mary Nell had a most beautiful plaque. It's got a great picture of Leon on it and a very nice sentiment. And then our names at the bottom. I was going to make this big long speech, and you know how this is, but the more I've talked to Emily and everything, I'm going to cut it down really short and just say, we love you, Leon. Maybe read the inscription on the plaque, but Leon's not big about wanting all the kudos and awards and things like this, and this is not to make him feel uncomfortable, but just another way to tell him how much we care.
I never thought I'd get a chance to get to look at you and do this. I think after you came and graced us with your presence for 2 hours this afternoon, I think you know how we feel, and you thrilled all of our hearts giving us your time this afternoon. I would like to read this to you. Presented to the master of space and time, Leon Russell. Thank you for a lifetime of music and entertainment, for the beauty in your songs, for the excellence in your craft, and for the spirit and love you share through your gifts and talents.
Leon, we love you.
What we wanted. We wanted to honor him, to give him back just a little bit of what he's given to us all these years. There's no way to repay him. No way.
Well, I tell you what a surprise. What a wonderful thing this is. You know, I'm going to cry now.
All right.
It's a weird, my life is a weird thing, you know. Ambrose and I were in Detroit, Michigan with Willie Nelson's show on Easter Sunday, and I said to Willie and Ambrose, I said, you know, this is a hotbed of Church of God in Christ. You know, I love the preachers, and I love Church of God in Christ in particular. I love that kind of music, that kind of talking, that kind of singing. I don't agree with some of the ideas, but we won't get into that. And I said, let's go to the Easter musical. Let's find an Easter musical to go to. So we set off and went out in the ghetto in Detroit. Try to find a musical to go on the Easter walk up. This guy is leaving church, had his little girl in the back, just getting ready to leave church. And I walked up to the car, and she started climbing out. She said, Jesus, Jesus. Oh, her daddy was going to slap her. Get back here. I said, you know where there's any Easter musicals? I want to take my friends to see an Easter musical. He said, no, I don't want to. So I went down and asked somebody else. I said, well, there's a church down here. So I went down there, and it's about 1,500 seat church. They were shouting. I liked that. That's the thing that first caught my attention from the Church of God in Christ. So I ran down while they were shouting. I ran down to the organist, just like I owned the joint, and said, is there a musical that we could go to today? And he said, well, the bishop of the Church of God in Christ is having a musical today at some such and such an auditorium starting at 1 o'clock. So he's got a choir, 300 voice choir, and it's going to really be something. So I took Ambrose and Willie, and we went down there. Of course, the Church of God in Christ, if it means, if you say 1 o'clock, that means 3:30.
Right.
So it was a little bit early, but we got down there. First thing, I walked in the room, in the restroom, there's little boys in there smoking. They said, you're the devil. I said to Ambrose, only in my life can I be Jesus and the devil. Inside of 15 minutes on Easter Sunday. So that's kind of the story of my life, you know. I'm Jesus and the devil. Santa Claus sometimes. And so we went into the room. It was early, of course, and we sat down about 25 rows back, and people started coming in, and all of a sudden, I looked around. There's this great big vacancy of seats, about 25 seats in every direction, and they sit all around us, all back in the back and all in the front, a big circle around us. And Church of God in Christ is a black church, in case you didn't know that. And all of a sudden, there's this old man and his wife. He took his Bible, and he got up from his chair, and he came stomping up there. He sat right down next to Ambrose. Ambrose got up and bowed to it. And then that circle, that vacant circle, filled in. All those people were. So I think we got to try to fill in that circle. Yeah. That's all I got to say. I'm a singer. I don't know.
I was very surprised at how humbled he was and how moved he was by it, and also that his whole family was there, and he was happy with that. He wasn't nervous about that. He just really pulled right in there and didn't back off a bit. In fact, did the total opposite. You know,
it felt like we were just kind of all sharing the love. You know, it was just really
just one big family.
Yeah.
To go over to Coyotes and have that little presentation, where he spoke and Ambrose spoke and Patrick spoke, and to have his family there and it was real emotional. I mean, for a lot of people. Yeah,
the prayer circle at the meet and greet.
Oh, everything was great.
The prayer circle, that was, I couldn't stand it. Oh my gosh.
Was that your highlight?
Oh man, I was crying like a baby.
You weren't alone.
Oh man.
That as we join hands, that the power of your love will permeate our lives, oh God. We'll direct and focus, oh God, as we come to have a rock and roll good time tonight, oh God, to lift you up, oh God, as our maestro, as our cantor, oh God, as our minister of music comes to sing praises unto your name, oh God, oh Lord. We don't perceive just one part of you to be holy. You are all everything, oh God. You are in everything, oh God. We don't separate you, oh God. You are everything, oh God. How can we separate you, oh God? You made everything. We bless you again for Leon. Touch his family. Bless them, oh God. Bless his children, oh God, and the seed of their seed, oh God. For ages to come. Bless every family home represented here, oh God. Lord, forgive us of our sin, of the little small things, not loving each other like we should. Lord, we know we're just humans, oh God, but we come into you right now telling you thank you. Thank you for your loving kindness. Thank you for your peace that is in our lives. We glorify you and we thank you for this opportunity. Lord, bless tonight, oh God. Let the house be full and let a good time be had by all.
Amen.
In the Son of Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Well, I couldn't stop dancing. I mean, I started boogieing and could not stop.
The energy was incredible last night.
I think the effort that he put out matched or exceeded the effort that the crowd put out. And this crowd has only been looking forward to this for months.
Hell, I was exhausted. I thought, where does he get that? That incredible Leon energy is all still right there. I mean, how the hell does he do that for 75 minutes? I can't even imagine how he sustains that kind of intensity. Intensity and perfection. That band was so hot. Teddy Jack. Who taught him to play drums like that? Couldn't be his dad, could it? I had no idea. I'd never really paid attention. I never just let myself be captured into that. And he was so smoking hot last night. I was just dumbfounded.
Yeah.
Oh, I started going, and it was just never, I was, just this one song. Just this one song. You know, he just had me like a puppet string. You know I love my sweet L.O.D. What was fun last night watching the show when Patrick came out and this one came out, and that's that format that Leon does best. When he's over there, you know, this one and this one and this one. And last night was the real opportunity for him to do that. Little appearances here, little appearances there.
Well, when Patrick sang His Eyes on the Sparrow last night, that was something else. I see you.
Last night, I couldn't. I kind of lost it for a little bit.
All these people came from all over the places to come see this music. I'm so happy. Some folks didn't get to come. I've been asked to sing this song. It's a request. This is for Bobby Collins. I met his lovely wife today. I didn't know Bobby, but he couldn't come tonight. And they tell me that it was something that he wanted to do very badly. This song, I'm going to sing it for him. They wanted Stranger in a Strange Land. I'm going to do that later, but I'm going to take this song out to sing for Bobby because I think she'll like it.
Bobby Collins had been, he's probably been on one list since in the middle of summer last year. And about, he was always, when he wrote his emails, he always was so cheerful and upbeat, and he was a Christian. And he was just always spreading the joy he had in his heart. That came through with his emails. I mean, always happy, and it was always, you know, good to hear from him.
You know, Bobby was a student. He was an actor. And Bobby and I bonded on the list. We sent a lot of emails back and forth. In fact, he sent me an email saying, you know, you're in school, I'm in school. We're a little different in ages. You know, I'm 46. I think Bobby was 28 or 29. And he needed an audition piece, a little 60-second dramatic piece for an audition. And he couldn't find anything. So I sent him three or four things that I keep in my repertoire when I go to auditions. And he used one of them, and darn it, he got the part, you know. And so we locked right then.
I'm trying to think about January. He wrote me off the list one time, and he said he didn't want to put it on the one list because he didn't want to just bother everybody. But he had, he was going to have to face a surgery. His heart was fine, but his ascending and descending aorta, it was something he was born with, that was weak. It was subject to rupturing, and so they had replaced one or the other a couple years ago that they were going to go in and replace the other one. And he wrote me and Rick Taylor and said, you know, I didn't want to bother everybody, but he said, I'm just kind of scared. I want to talk to somebody.
I got an email saying, you know, Bobby was going to the hospital. He had some sudden problems.
So he went in and had the surgery, and I got to talk to him the day I called him. Got to talk to him the day before he went in the hospital. And then each day, sister-in-law would write, and then I'd pass the word on how he was doing.
We were getting reports from Jennifer and his mother, you know, the whole time after he had surgery. And
His favorite Leon song was Stranger in a Strange Land, and there was a time when he was in the hospital that he was like in a coma. I think it was more right after the surgery, and you know, it takes a day or two to really get to wake up, but his vital signs weren't doing too good.
His heart rate was way up, and they were having some problems, and his wife, Jennifer, said that she put on Stranger in a Strange Land, which was one of Bobby's favorite songs, and watched the heart monitor drop back down.
And his heartbeat got stronger, his pulse and blood pressure started rising.
Just a few tinkles of the eye on a recording, you know, a little acetate disc could change a man's heart rate.
And actually, the day after he got out of intensive care, I called just hoping to get to talk to Jennifer, his wife, see how he's doing. She goes, you want to talk to him? And I said, well, yeah, sure. He was still very weak, but you could still hear that happiness and that joy in his voice, even as weak as he sounded. So I said, I won't bother you too long, but I just want to tell you we love you, we're praying for you, and we're anxious to see you in Louisville.
Well, I'll tell you this. I the other night before we came down, I was like trying to review like people and their likes and dislikes, which was basically impossible a few days before the show. But I read Bobby's questionnaire, and one of the questions on it was, have you ever seen Leon? And he was like, no, but he can't wait for Louisville.
The surgery went good, but his other vital organs started failing.
And then just incredibly, you know, Bobby died.
And I remember it was a Sunday morning. She wrote and said, I hate to tell you all this, but we lost Bobby today. And it just... still bugging me. I miss him, but...
And what was really bad, and I don't know if the other ones found out the way I did, because it happened over Memorial Day weekend, so I post at work. I don't have my computer over the weekend. So I was getting these reports on his prognosis when I came back to work, because I start with the oldest messages first, and it was like, well, he's running fever, but he's keeping some food down, you know, and now he's a little better today. They had to put him back on the respirator. So when I got to the one that Rick wrote that said, I'm sadfully, you know, regretfully writing this, it was just like, I think I had to get up and go somewhere at work when I read that. It was, you know, just, it was sad, sad.
You could really just feel the pain that everyone was feeling when he didn't make it after his surgery. And again, I can't explain to you why it is. I'm getting all misty just thinking about it now. To tell you the truth, I was just devastated when that man died, and I never met him. So I can't quite explain to you why it is that I felt really as bad when he died as when some other friends of mine have died in the past that, you know, at such a young age. Nevertheless, there it is.
A young kid, rock and roll drummer, you know, that just, Leon Russell was part of, such a part of his life. And all of a sudden, there's a void. Bobby used to sign all of his posts, rock and roll, Bobby. I never met him. We exchanged pictures on the internet. We wrote each other a lot of emails. And then reading his posts, he just was vibrant and full of life. And Leon and his music were, I mean, really a part of this kid. And he just was gone.
When Bobby passed away, that was devastating for all of us that had gotten to know him on the internet and yet never touched his skin, never sat in a room with him, but felt like I knew him like a brother, you know. And everybody was there to hold each other up through it. So
I hope no more things like that, you know. But if something else like that does happen, we will be stronger together for having each other.
Even though I never met him, Bobby's part of my life. His nom de guerre, you know, rock and roll Bobby, has become part of what I speak. You know, when I talk to people, or I'll close a post, I say, you know, rock and roll. Which never meant anything to me. It was just a music genre. But it's gone from being just a type of music to a greeting that a dear friend of mine used to close his emails with. And I can't hear rock and roll without thinking of Bobby Collins.
I was looking through my Christmas cards. Usually I discard them after Christmas, and I found the one that Bobby had sent me last Christmas, and it was really sad.
And his wife sent us emails, you know, painful emails, because she'd lost her husband, and they were both young, and hadn't been married long. And she reached out to Bobby's family. She said it was tougher to go be with his mom and dad and brothers and sisters at the funeral than to reach out to his other family, you know, the Lifers.
We all got together and we wanted to do something for Bobby because it was neat. And so these are our Bobby ribbons. Pat Hoppy made these, and we wanted something. We didn't know what color ribbon to do. And Jennifer, Bobby's wife, said that hot pink was Bobby's favorite color. And so we wanted to make these ribbons, and these are for Bobby.
So this weekend, his wife and his dad are going to be here at the concert.
We're anxious to meet Jennifer when she gets here this afternoon, but that's what that's all about, just to remember him, and he'll always have a place in our heart.
You know, there's a tribute. We've got a vase that there will be probably end up being dozens of roses in that probably will end up on Leon's piano, and that's Bobby. Bobby's here.
He'll be watching tonight, you know, and he'll be cheering us on, and we'll be getting our woo-woos in, so.
You know, if Bobby was here, he'd be standing in the back, woo-wooing and just having a ball and, you know, rocking and rolling.
Got up on stage last night for Great Balls of Fire. I mean, It just doesn't get any better than that, you know?
All his children up on stage dancing has to be exceptional.
I said, I don't know what to say about the concert last night. Because I've never seen one like, I mean, I've seen moments like that, obviously. And there has been great, great Leon shows over the years.
The show was extraordinary, I have to say. I think the show was as good in its own way as that show that I saw in 1972. I
mean. But this far and away outstripped anything I've ever seen personally. I was a kid back in the early 70s, so I couldn't go to the big shows that I've seen tapes of since then. But last night was so much more than I ever imagined. Any kind of concert is not even a good word for what happened last night. It's just so beyond that it's indescribable.
To say it was one for the ages doesn't do it justice at all. To say it was, you know, a tremendous concert is a classic understatement.
But what I love is that he's the best is yet to come. And I think we all saw that last night.
Ambrose told me that we only have 26 letters in the alphabet, and that's all the words we have to describe things that we feel and see and smell and touch and hear. And what's been going on with this concert we had with Leon is more than those 26 letters would be able to do.
But I know it was an injection in all of us and an awakening for all the Leon people, past and present, to wake up. It's time. It's now time to get back together. It was like we were all young and in our 20s and 30s, and we always kept in touch. But it's now time to get back to where we once belonged, to cop up, you know, the old beat, get back, Loretta, get back to where you once belonged, and get the music back out there. Because there's a whole bunch of people that have never heard this kind of music. They've heard this kind of music because of Leon's influence on music. And they need to realize where a lot of it's come from.
A lot of us could have dreamed it, but we couldn't have ever expected it.
It to be this good. I mean, it was more than anybody ever dreamed.
I thought that this would be just, another day on the job, so to speak, with some fringe lunatic fans that he would humor, possibly. And I didn't really think it would be that, but still, you don't know. And it seems like it was a lot more than that to even him.
I think Leon is glad that there's LeonLifers. He's not quite sure how to deal with it, perhaps, because he's a very private man, but he's glad they're there.
The lifers reminded him, held the mirror up last night. It's that old, those old tapestries. For him to take a look at who he really is and what he's really about, and reminded him. That's why the lifers just are incredible.
But I think the timing was incredible. And I think it's something that he wanted and needed as much as we did.
He needed that. We all needed that. You all needed it to make sure, I think, you weren't nuts out there on the internet doing all this stuff. And he needed it for the same reason.
He's a man we all believe that should have gotten much more recognition than he's definitely got his due recognition. And I think what he got from us last night, I think, is probably equivalent to more than any of those awards could ever mean. I think that's truly why he plays and gives his music to us. And I think to see it come back at him last night like that was...
It takes a lot of energy to do what he does. He plays, 120 nights a year, and he's 58 years old and has a huge family. And he so needed this, you all's energy, to remind him it's worth it. What you do is so worth it.
I've never seen Leon that move that much. He's shocked.
I didn't expect that. I thought that he'd be appreciative of it, but I didn't think that it would be, it would move him so much, and didn't realize how important it was to him to get this kind of feedback from his fans, because we just assume that he knows how much we love him and love his music. And
we love Leon, and we hope that he had, that it meant as much to him as it meant to us, because it meant a lot to all of us. I mean, the world, this is a once-in-a-lifetime thing.
The emotion, the feeling that we go home with and take from this weekend or these 2 days is going to last with all of us forever.
It is. It's something very special. And I think it'll last a lifetime. Maybe 2 or 3.
But I really do believe this is just the beginning. This is no ending. This is just the beginning.
Places in my life and time, sung a lot of songs, I made some bad rhymes, acted out my life in state with 10,000 people watching, but we're alone now and I'm singing this song for you. And I know your image of me is what I hope to be. Treated you unkindly, can't you see? But no one more important to me. Darling, can't you please see through me? When we're alone and I'm singing this song for you. You taught me precious secret, the truth withholding nothing. You came out in front and I was hiding. Now I'm so much better. If these words don't come together, listen to the melody, my love is in the hiding. Where there's no space and time, I love you for my life, darling, you're a friend of mine. And I will sing.
Because the best is yet to come.